Let us exit the facility.
Yes.
We found some really interesting Numenera things here. I want to use that thing, you know, as soon as we get out of here. You gonna fight us now? Kor was still here, hand clenched to his wound. Well, you made it back. I expect murderous drones were no match for you. Not at all. I expected more of a challenge after what they did to you. Silver tide. Ah, but I'm more fragile and mortal than you, he says bitterly. I depend on luck and dead friends, as it seems. He looks away. Never mind that. I have a favor to ask. Tell Salimeri I helped you. I did, after all. These murders would have attacked you. I killed them first. We even destroyed a few of the drones before we fled. Okay. Well, at least one of the murders was destroyed by the drones, not you. He meets her eyes again. She wants to dismiss me. Help me change her mind, and I'll tell you something I know about the Order of Truth. You seem awfully concerned about Salimeri's opinion. A good employer is hard to find these days, he says, studying the air above your head. He thinks, none as clever and beautiful as she is, anyway. Blue tide? Or not? Blue tide is knowledge, I think? I saw the way you looked at her, and me, when you learned she knew me. You love her, don't you? I didn't get anything. His eyes widen, then his mouth firms. Fine. I love her. There, I've said it. And I don't want to leave her side, even if she doesn't feel the same way. Oh, Koro, Kalishtez sighs. She's utterly beyond your reach, my dear. Of course she is, he says sharply. That doesn't change a thing. I deserve more than secrets for doing your dirty work. Silver tide. Fine, he says without hesitation. I'll give you something from my private collection, but only after you tell her. Will you? I'll tell her you helped.
Making a note.
Gold tide. Excellent. I'll hold you to that. Now, the secret, as promised. He winces, hand moving to his side. Lan Yuring. The boy is a spy for the Memovira. I'm not sure why. He loves the Order well enough. I was going to blackmail him, but... He grins. Priorities change, I suppose. I'll see you back at the Order, Falling Star. See ya! Which was this again? Oh, metal panels. Alright, let's go.
Ready.
Back to the Order of Truth. Now we have three things to talk about. That he helped. That we finished this thing. And what they might know about
All right.
the body and the danger of her and all that. Which I kind of forgot about.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Okay. We are here. Oh, Koro's here. Don't forget your promise. Oh, you tipped her off. Standing right here in front of you. Ah, there you are, Salimeri says, beaming, and holds out a smooth palm. The Eye of the Mlox, please. You hand it over and she returns it to her workstation. Then she gracefully inclines her head in Koro's direction. Was he of any use to you? Koro gives you a pleading look. Yes, he was. Tide, even though I'm helping myself, because he's going to give me something, supposedly. Very well. Koro, you can stay. Do try to limit your failures in the future to matters I care less about. Koro exhales all at once and nods in your direction. Poor guy. Now I feel sorry for him. And he was the The, what do you call it? The thug from the beginning who wanted to capture us. Funny how things change. Ooh, we got a ring of entanglement. With that out of the way, she says, here's a reward for your considerable effort. Thank you. It looks like we gained 2 rings of entanglement. And 80 shins. By the way, I managed to save a few of the drones in the lazarette from Peerless. She nearly jumps. Lower your voice, she whispers. Astonishing. Your predecessor couldn't have done better. She passes you a heavy bag from her workstation. A small bonus. Keep what you've learned in there to yourself until my book is finished. I've gained an aref. I've solved your problem. Now I need help fixing the resonance chamber. Well, I remember what Adan told me, she says, frowning. The chamber was built with living crystals from a world called the Ascension. Your predecessor was remarkably resistant to telling me what it was for, regardless of the interrogation methods I employed. Her mouth quirks. She thinks, at least the interrogations were exciting. She only said that it would stop the sorrow and that none of the cast-offs could know about it, which seemed odd to me at the time. Escaping the sorrow wouldn't be in all your best interests, I would think. She snaps her fingers. Seek out the cast-off who helped her build it. That surly artificer whose name escapes me at the moment.
Making a note.
Which one? I forgot his name. She continues. And I only saw him once. He has machines buzzing away in his body and circuits embedded in his flesh. She taps her lip thoughtfully. Speak to Adan's little cult in Circus Minor if you haven't already. They always seem to know who your brothers and sisters are. Okay. Outrageous, Kalistez mutters. Allegrin was actually right about something? Now, Kalistez. The man is exceptional in his own way. Just because he can't match your analytical speed doesn't mean that he does not have gifts and wisdom of his own. She arches an eyebrow to you. At any rate, seek out the cult. They should know how to find your machine man brother. That's all you know? You are your mother's daughter, aren't you? You're just like her. We just raised silver and blue. Adan was fascinating, intense, focused on building that chamber. Passionate one moment, and distant as the stars the next. I never understood why. She half turns away from you. Oh, and Adan was ruthless. Utterly ruthless. I am living proof of that. Tell me who could fix the resonance chamber again. The artificer castor who helped build it, I suppose. The changing god in Circus Minor might be able to help you find him. Farewell. I thank you, Carl mutters, clapping your shoulder awkwardly as you pass, and handing you a small jingling bag. Can't say I would have done the same in your place. Okay, so we gained a burning mouse and 30 shins. And I have to move around Fettles again. Perhaps I'll see you again. I do believe she's warming to me. Is that what you think it is? Back so soon? She says, raising an eyebrow. You're far more dependable than Adan ever was. She pauses. In some ways, at least. That's it. Alright, what do we have? We have a burning mouse. It's actually a mouse. Immediately remove all positive and status Fettles from all enemies. In addition, gain Burning Mouse, plus 50% on perception tasks. Active entire crisis. This small statue of a mouse fits in the palm of your hand. Its pale red eyes glow and flicker like the embers of a fire. Instead of fur, the statue is covered in images of flame and is always warm to the touch. When whispered instructions, the mouse will come alive and scout the area for traps and hidden secrets. Nice! Cool. That could come in handy. I want to give this one to Kalistez. Okay. Now, I just want to save before I go start messing around with stuff. because I'm going to start messing around with stuff. Okay, so we've got an Araf. Ooh, it's an artifact. You've seen this ring fragment before. It is known as Araf, or Power Taken, and is one half of the artifact known as the Shadow Ring. Cool. You recall that this artifact belonged to a cast-off, although their identity escapes you. You remember only that the Changing God himself sundered this ring at the height of a cold rage and infused each half with mutually repellent energies. They have been separated from each other ever since. The Changing God went through immense trouble to separate these two rings. It must be possible to reunite them. Okay, so maybe I shouldn't use item then. But I think artifacts can be used more than once. We do have two rings of entanglement. The two characters wearing these matching rings share all fetals and 25% of stats healed. Oh, they come as a pair. This loop of metal is constructed from a short band that splits and branches, threads twisting and bending in upon themselves before seamlessly reforming at the other end. The coils are maddeningly knotted, making it impossible to trace a complete path, yet at the same time a pattern waits to be revealed, just beyond the edge of comprehension. Of the handful unearthed through the ages, these rings were once dismissed as mere trinkets, until an unnamed collector discovered twins purely by chance. It is said that this man wore one of the matched set and gifted his lover with the other. During one particularly amorous encounter, both were astounded by their shared sensations and an oddly heightened sense of awareness. When the couple identified the rings as the source of this connection, further use showed that they mutually experienced every physical pain, pleasure, and sickness felt by either. This effect disappeared when they wore an unmatched pair of bands. My mystical lore tells me that rings of entanglement are valued by many, including hedonists, thrill-seekers, the infirm, and even kidnappers, who warn that any violence done to them will also harm the victims. The rings are now thought to exist only as unique pairs and are highly sought after. Interesting. Same. Share all fetals and 25% of stats healed? So you heal one, the other one gets healed 25% as much. And we lost the eye thing. Quest item. Oh, I wish I could move it over. Alright. I don't know. Who do I want to share that with? That seems like a very intimate thing, especially given the story. I think I'm just going to hold on to them for now. Spray flash, well... I guess I ran out of spray flash. I'll keep it with all this. I wonder if I don't remember where I got this from. The synth globe clearly depicts an unknown world. The more you look at it, the more details you discover, as if the globe somehow enhances and concentrates your vision as you examine it. I wonder if it helps perception. Let's see if anything changes. I don't see anything changing. Oh. Okay. We have the antagonist, which you can't do anything with, and we got this thing. Chromavulum. You take the object out of your pack and hold it up by the attached cord, studying it as it spins before you. It reminds you of certain creatures found in the sea, attached to rocks, only this one has a cord of material looped through a hole in one of its legs. Examine the creature. The creature has tough, briny skin and 7 spindly legs that emit radially from a thicker, fleshy disc at its center. Around the disc on one side is a circle of puckered flesh surrounding a tightly closed, muscular flap, while the other side is a similar flap but is otherwise smooth. A flap. Examine the loop of elastic material. The material is flexible but soft, stretching up to nearly twice its original length when you pull on it. Your best guess is that the loop was meant to allow the creature to be worn in some fashion. Wear it like... Do I have a necklace or belt? Let me see. No, the necklace would go here. Where would a belt go? Over the body? I don't have a slot for waist. You know, it's probably going to turn into a bonded item anyway. Let me try. Let me try for belt. Wear it like a belt. You stretch the loop of material to its limit and slip it over your shoulders and down around your waist. Some might find it stylish, but it has no effect. Wear it like a necklace. Inclining your head, you slip the loop over and around your neck where it contracts to fit snugly. The attached creature settles over your chest. You walk a few paces and find that it's somewhat uncomfortable to have the creature thumping against you with every step. After a minute or so of this, you feel silly and start to take it off. But as you pull the loop up back over your head, the creature brushes against your face and suddenly twitches. You wrench the creature away and watch for signs of further movement, but it seems just as lifeless as before. Cautiously, you bring the creature closer to your face. At first, it does not respond, but as you move it around, you discover that it only comes to life when it's near one of your eyes. Do I dare? Is this thing going to eat my frickin' eye? Wear it like an eye patch? Stretching the loop slightly, you gingerly place it around your head, allowing the creature to settle just in front of your right eye. It comes to life, contorting its legs to match the contours of your face. Your right eye is completely blinded by the obstruction. Suddenly, you experience a sensation not unlike someone blowing a single puff of air directly into your eye. Oh yeah, I've been to the eye doctor. I had those little puff test things. You blink several times involuntarily, but only with your free eye. The creature is forcefully keeping your other eye open. Probing around the creature's edges, you discover that it has formed a perfect seal over your eye. If this was me in real life, I'd be really, really frightened right now. I'd be terrified. Tears form in your covered eye, and a wet, slithering noise accompanies a most bizarre sensation as your vision clears. It takes you a moment to realize that the creature is blinking for you, which is quickly displaced by the realization that you can once again see out of the previously blinded eye. The creature is still in place, but you are somehow looking through it. What the hell? Delicately, you feel around the surface of the creature. You find that the creature's briny skin has slid aside to reveal a smooth, slightly flexible substance that seems to be acting as a lens. Each time you tap it, the creature blinks, the muscular flap swatting your finger aside as it presumably cleans the lens. While much of the world appears the same through your covered eye, certain things appear in hues that are wholly unfamiliar to you. Your mind struggles to process what it's seeing, and you know that if you had to attempt to describe the colors to someone, you would fail utterly. It's the color out of space. It's a color that we've never seen before. We gained some experience. As wondrous as your newfound sight is, you find it highly disorienting and resume your search for a way to detach the creature. After some experimentation, you discover that simply removing the loop from around your neck causes the creature to release its grip. You feel around your face for any permanent scarring, but the creature has left no mark. Wear it like an eye patch again? Will this grant me, like, special vision? You fit the loop around your head, and again the creature seals itself to your eye. When it opens, the world is again awash in strange colors. You take a moment to appreciate the sheer beauty of the spectacle around you before removing it once more. Huh. I wonder if this is going to have any practical purpose. You know anything about this, Salimeri? Never mind, you don't know. Let's talk to the man in charge, Min of Tan Liang, who's actually one of the backers of the game. You see him on the one of the introduction screens. Rubbing his temples with grease-stained fingers, the tall priest nods at you. Lan Yuring has been spying on you for the Memovera. Surprise washes the gentle mirth from Min's face to to reveal the stone expression of the man who protects the priesthood from plots of Sagus's governors, the head of the Order of Truth. He turns to address Lan, but the younger man is already on his way over, stammering and trembling. Oh, that is him. I thought it was just some random person walking up. I didn't have a chance, Min, he says, his eyes red-rimmed, desperate. They said they would kill me if I kept anything from them. Yeah? Well, good news. You're safe now, because you'll never have access to the Order of Truth again. Pack your things and get out. He thinks, how many secrets has he passed on to her? If only we knew. You should give him another chance. Gold. He's done enough damage to get him kicked out 100 times, Min growls. You don't know how many times our dig sites have been ransacked by the Memovera's thugs because of him? How many artifacts have been lost forever? He points Lan to the door. Get out. With a soft, wounded gasp, Lan obeys. When the initiate is out of range, Min breathes a shuddering sigh and runs his hands through his dark hair. I hated that. The kid deserved better, but I guarantee at least one of the priests have gone missing on expeditions. I guarantee at least one of the priests who have gone missing on expeditions isn't missing at all. Probably stripped of robes and relics and buried in a shallowed grave thanks to him. He massages his eyes. Any other questions or revelations for me today? Well, speaking of your eyes... I want to ask him about that thing, but I don't think we can. Wow, we have 541 shins. That's nice. Do you have any more time to talk about mechanical Numenera? The responsible answer is no, but no one needs me to sign anything right now, so yes. Yes, I do. You already talked to me about this stuff. Yeah, we've already talked about everything. Okay. Come back and mix soon. Let's see what Snurf has anything new to say. Though we could ask him about the Dendra or her. Nope. Ta-da-da. I like this theme.
Yes.
That's it. That's all the people?
Yes.
We messed with this thing before, but weren't able to figure anything out. We I just want to get closer. We have a chance to look at this thing through the Chromavulum thing. So this, right, to remind, this is a small wireframe pyramid sitting on a base of polished wood. Lying inside the pyramid is a dull sphere of silverish metal. We're going to put on this fish thing. Acting on a hunch, you retrieve the Chromavulum and place it over your eye. After adjusting to having the creature attached to your face again, you shift your gaze to the orb. The orb appears much as it did before. Slightly disappointed, you decide to leave the creature in place for now. Oh, there's got to be something to this. Read the inscription. Oh, this might show me the correct colors now. You know, that are referred to by this thing. Your eyes flash over the foreign shapes, their meaning still not clear. Crimson dawn greets the seeker. The violet dusk sees the search's end. Alright, so I want paper. Red, I think, is begin. And then violet is end. Remove, lift. Man. Okay. Remove it. To the left. Turn to the right. The sphere changes to a color unlike any you've ever seen before. In trying to find a way to describe it to yourself, you notice elements of orange and hints of yellow, but by and large, it is something beyond your ability to convey. Lift the frame. Shining yellow. I removed it from left. Right? And then put it front? No. Move it left. Right. Okay. So remove... I don't know, left. Right. Left, right, to make sure that's back, no. Left, right. The sphere changes to the unusual color that's somewhat like orange, but also substantially different from any color you've seen before. Really? Back? No. Left? Right? Okay, not front. Left. Right. Left. Left. Right. I think it's left, right, back. Yeah. Or... Or right again, either one. Left. Right. Back? No. Left. Right. Right. Front. Nope. Left. Right. Right. Left. The sphere changes to an unusual color that's part violet, and part something you have trouble describing. Alright, let's try front. Nope. Left. Right. I'm just brute forcing this here, obviously. Right. Left. Left. Nope. Left. Right. Right. Left. Right. It's right again. Orange, but also substantially different. The sphere changes to a color. Oh. I don't know. I really don't know, guys. As you step away from the device, the sphere dulls to its original silver. Not wanting to stumble around due to the radical changes it makes to your vision, you remove the chromavulum from your eye and stow it away. So wait.
Yes, now.
Left. Right. Right. Left. Okay, I don't know. Guess we're done in here.
Yes.
Bunk, bunk, bunk.
Go.
I really want to figure that thing out. What the hell? That weird sphere. Well, that's Circus Miner. What's his name's gonna have to hang on, because we need our stuff back. I have plenty of money. Off screen, I'm going to go sleep at the cult of the changing god. And then I'm going to head back to the underbelly to talk to, what's his name? Murders. Folsom. Another person has been killed, a little mutant woman named Crooked Keek. And supposedly he's furious with us. He only helped her fish.
Eretus, Eretus, Eretus.
Yes, Eretus? I was just thinking how wonderful it would be if there were three of us.
Is he talking to himself? Alright, thanks for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.